Alaska Insight is supported in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and by viewers just like you. Thank you.
With schools closed across Alaska through at least May 1st, parents and teachers are getting creative about how to encourage and show support for students. Districts statewide are working to deliver distance education in rural and urban Alaska. How can students stay positive and on track with their studies in this time of uncertainty? We'll discuss it tonight on Alaska Insight. Good evening. We're live this evening to bring you the latest information on COVID-19 in Alaska. Tonight, Governor Dunleavy issued a statewide shelter-in-place mandate that goes into effect tomorrow at 5 p.m. It asks all Alaskans to stay home as much as possible and closes non-essential businesses. Grocery stores, restaurants for takeout service, and gas stations are among the businesses that will remain open. Governor Dunleavy says Alaskans can still enjoy outdoor activities as long as they stay 6 feet apart. The other new mandate restricts travel between communities in the state unless that travel is to support critical infrastructure or is critical for personal needs. Tonight on Alaska Insight, we're talking about how schools across the state are dealing with the COVID-19 pandemic and how parents can navigate this difficult and uncertain time. To maintain social distancing, Alaska Public Media has closed our physical location to the public with a few exceptions. As you see, we're using a different set to provide distance between my single studio guest and myself. Our other guests are here by phone this evening. Joining me tonight in the studio is Dr. Tammy Lubitsch-White. Dr. White is a psychologist based in the Anchorage area, and she is here this evening to offer guidance on how parents and other caregivers can help children deal with the anxiety of our current situation. Tammy, welcome.
Hi.
Thanks so much for being here. And joining us by phone is Dr. Dina Bishop. Dina is the superintendent of the Anchorage School District. Hello, Dina. Thanks for being here.
Hello. Thank you.
And joining us from Kotzebue is Terry Walker. Terry is the superintendent of the Northwest Arctic Borough School District. Terry, thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
As I mentioned earlier, we are live on this Friday evening and we're streaming live to Alaska Public Media's Facebook page. You can submit questions there for school officials or Dr. White, and we'll get to as many as we can. Dina, please start us off. How are plans progressing for ASD moving to online and, for some families, paper packet delivery of course materials?
Well, we're progressing right along. On Tuesday is the first day that it is truly live. We've had supplemental materials for parents to access online and for kids to kind of get used to the online platforms, as well as practicing Zoom, which is the electronic platform, you know, that folks can meet, teachers can see each other from students. Monday we have planned disbursement of our computers and some hotspots for families that need those in order to progress in their academics. We're really focusing on credits at high school, especially our graduates and those folks that are about to graduate, and that's that success for life. And in middle school, we're really looking at parents as partners, and of course at the elementary, as parents as teachers.
And Terry, you have more challenging logistics for distance learning in your district. How are you dealing with getting materials to students?
Yeah, we're spread out over 39,000 square miles, 11 communities with no roads connecting. And the internet access to some of these communities is very limited. So we have all teachers that have created packets for students. And have delivered those packets, and they also are communicating via audio conference. So students are set up with audio conference lines that they can call into and meet with the teacher daily. And for the high school, it's a class, and they have a form called Canvas that students can pull down assignments and then work them and submit them back to Canvas. And so, of course, those are students and with internet in the home, so it does work for some students. And then there are those that may not have a telephone nor internet, and so communicate is handheld radios like VHF radios, and so they are giving instructions, providing instructions via VHF radios and some other things. So it's a variety of ways of communicating depending on student needs.
Right. Sounds like you do have quite a variety of VHF radios included in that mix. Tammy, we're early in this school closure. It will be at least another 6 weeks. It could possibly be longer. What advice do you have for parents to help their kids and themselves deal with this being cooped up for such a long stretch of time together?
First, acknowledging the fact that it's hard and it's different. And also there's an opportunity in doing that. So first, the adults in the household need to sit together and make a plan, and a plan that is conducive to who they are and who their children are and what their children needs are, and create as much predictability and consistency in their life. And for the adult specifically, it's important to check in, to finish the day, say how was the day, what went well, what didn't, and keep changing and updating the plan. But having a plan is really important, and the kid feels contained when they know, okay, this is what we're going to do tomorrow, and work with what we have and keep changing, you know, what doesn't work and continue doing what does work.
Mm-hmm. Do you recommend that they try to keep as close to the same schedule as they had during school as possible, or is it okay to let the kids sleep in some and adjust their schedules because they are at home for such long periods of time?
Whatever works. For every family, something else will work. So they can, as long as it is predictable and it's structured and the kids are involved in creating it too, depends on their age, but they know that, you know, kind of there is structure. For some family, it's not realistic to keep the same structure, so don't push yourself, because then you get extra stress, stress because of the situation, and then stress because you don't do what you're supposed to do. Make it family specific.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Today, ASD, Anchorage School District, and Alaska Public Media announced a new partnership to assist students with at-home learning during the school closures. Dina, tell us how this will help students access education materials.
Well, that's really a terrific partnership, not only for Anchorage, but all students around Alaska. Many times, as we are even hearing from the phone line, those places that are in rural Alaska don't have such great connections or can't learn synchronously. So a lot of their work would be asynchronous, individual work. One of the things that we can do is use the TV. Many of us adults, we remember, you know, Conjunction Junction and all those other educational programs that have gone out in the past. You know, we have many already, and we are just going, it's a great opportunity to use the television. I know that parents are sometimes worried about screen time, whether it's screen time on a TV or in front of a computer or game, but knowing that these programs actually reinforce education and, you know, the kinds of learning that we want children to have, we want to put our parents at rest that those opportunities will help and will create, you know, part of that schedule as well, so that when it's time to view a certain program, whether it's in science or English or what it may be, that could be a time that is built into that schedule, as Dr. White said, and something to look forward to.
Terry, this programming will also be available over the ARC system. Do you, after hearing Dina explain it, I know this is new information, but do you see that this could be another way also to incorporate distance education into that mix of all of the other methods that you described earlier?
Absolutely. Any kind of resource that's available in the home that the students have,
I wish we had a better phone connection so we could hear you better, Terry, but it definitely is an illustration of the challenges that we're facing in Alaska when it comes to distance education because of the wide-ranging abilities to connect on the internet and even just phone service, as we see. Dina and Terry, the U.S. Congress, the House just today, and the Senate earlier, passed a historic spending package that will send more than $2 trillion to businesses and individuals to try to slow the economic downturn. Are you aware of how this package may help schools? Dina, do you want to start us?
Sure. It actually absolutely will help schools, and I want everyone to know that the Anchorage School District, as well as many school districts around the state, continue to employ our employees, and we are involved in telework agreements, even for our aides and supportive staff, because they're on call, ready to help. Our disbursement of computers, thousands of computers will go into kids' hands on Monday, and we're utilizing staff to assist with that, with the protocols established by our health department. So we are, it's basically a drive-up and deposit using an app to connect with families and kids to register to receive one, and then parents would drive in. So just to let folks know, that will help. We're paying folks now for some times, and understanding that we may need to extend the school year or have early school maybe before August if we're back to a regular regimen in school. And it's going to cost additional dollars to be able to employ people to offer that to our families. So that's one way it's going to help. Another way, it's actually they're looking at right now, the Department of Education is looking at for families that struggle with young kids about connecting. They're looking at purchasing devices and working with large companies like Microsoft and Apple to purchase devices that actually have programs, learning programs already downloaded on them, so that you don't have to be connected to an internet to utilize that learning and that experience to keep up to date. One of the things we do, I know parents are always concerned about screen time, and online learning really is a combination of like a coach as a teacher encouraging a child and then giving practice on the computer. So it's never an isolated event where there's no feedback or response. And so I want our families to feel secure that actually in a Project Red, which is a meta-analysis of computerized learning, really shared that it's actually most advantageous for youth to be able to utilize online learning, especially on short duration, 15 to 20 minutes, to really hone skills, whether those are fundamental skills in mathematics or reading. So we do have evidence in long-scale studies that demonstrate that what may look like a game to an adult thinking, oh, the child's on the computer again, if we can download some of these programs, they're actually going to continue that learning moving forward. So the funds will help establish the needed materials now, as well as possibly carry over into the fall for additional teaching before school, maybe during breaks, once we do see a time where we can utilize school in more of a regular sense as we once knew it.
And I want our school officials to weigh in here on this point as well, but Tammy, what are your concerns about how children who have special needs will be able to adapt, and also their caregivers and parents during this time? It's stressful for all families to have close quarters and have to try to navigate working from home and education from home. And that is even a tougher challenge for families who have special needs children. Talk a little bit about what you're advising these parents and caregivers in this time.
To reach out for help. It's very, very, very difficult. It's, you know, and find all kind of creative ways how to social distance but not isolate it, specifically if you have a child that have special need, because you need that help, you need that respite. You need to know that you're not alone. Reach out to other parents, discuss solution, talk about openly about the problem. Don't be afraid to be vulnerable. It's time to reach out. Even though we're distancing, in terms of distance, we need to connect and actually be closer and reveal maybe things we didn't do before, because otherwise it's very, very difficult.
Mm-hmm. Terry, there is a package of funding that Representative Don Young is working on with one of the members of Congress from Rhode Island to include an additional $500 million for community learning centers to help for childcare and after-school programs. How could this funding help your district in particular in the remote regions that you are, the schools that you have in such remote regions?
Well, we don't have any childcare program. Parents who are trying to work and trying to go to their children. So, and we help students that are really start to be building their skills and academic team so that they're ready for kindergarten right in the beginning.
We are having such a hard time hearing you, Terry. I'm just so sorry about that. I wish we had a better connection, because I know that what you're saying is quite important, and I wish that we could hear your words. It's very frustrating. So excuse me, I'm going to go back to Dina for a moment. Dina, how is ASD involved in childcare efforts here in Anchorage?
Sure. Well, I would like to share some information. A couple of years ago, when we looked into having a later start school year for our adolescent kids, our high school kids, following what research demonstrates, science of kids' brains, that it is actually better for them, to go after 8 or 8:30 in the morning rather than starting early, we found through our study, and we had an expert come from the outside who studied cities our similar size. And one of the things that he found was the lack of before and after school care and partnerships in the city. For a city our size, he found that we were lacking in those types of after school programs. So we already know we're behind. Right now, we do have some great partners in Boys and Girls Clubs and Campfire. And what we have just signed this week with Campfire is to provide in four different schools some support, and really that support is going to be prioritized at this time to any healthcare provider who is working around the clock and families of healthcare providers, so that we can serve them first in this line of duty. And not certain of the particular schools at this time, but we have an agreement with Campfire that we will have students utilize in classrooms rather than a gym, how they used to in a large group and just move to the sides. They're going to utilize classrooms, make sure that kids are in the low risk and not have them near each other, and no more than 10 kids. Well, 9 kids plus an adult in a room, and they're going to provide the learning and care that they can for students. And we were going to utilize our fancy sprayers that we have for decontaminating, sanitizing rather the surfaces. You might have seen those on TV or in the news somewhere. They kind of look like the Ghostbuster guy walking through, spraying a mist, and it's a absolutely safe mist that can go around and can be on any surface and even on human bodies, on hands and whatnot. But it would help keep the cleanliness of the area. But that is to start next week.
And Dina, the Anchorage School District is delivering, and I'm sure that Terry's is as well, delivering a lot of meals to students that are no longer coming to school every day. The governor's mandate today about shelter in place, how will that affect what you're doing currently? Will you have to adjust how you're delivering food now?
Sure. Well, the governor's mandate is very similar to Mayor Berkowitz's mandate that he provided last week. And there are provisions for essential services. And utilization of distance learning is one of those. And that's why we can continue deploying our computers Monday to get them to people. Again, we're doing it in a drive-up fashion, similar to how many people are getting their tests for COVID-19. Drive up, again, nobody's touching. There aren't people gathering in groups. They're staying in their vehicle. The computers and the wires and everything are in a bag. And, you know, through an app, they're receiving those. The same is true for our lunch, our different areas that we're deploying, as well as on our buses. We've set up, with a guidance from the health department, protocols to not have people gather when we disperse them and actually have very safe distancing as well. We need to continue this. It is about the last few days have been 9,500 to 10,000 meals delivered. Today, we sent kids home with three meals, one for Friday and then one Saturday and Sunday. It was about a little over 28,000 meals that we delivered today to students that are breakfast and lunch in a bag together. Some heating is needed if kids need that. But it is absolutely essential in our city. On any given day, the Anchorage School District serves 24,000 to 27,000 meals, mm-hmm. depending on, you know, what it is that day. We know that there's a need in our city, and we absolutely cannot stop serving. We also fall under the provision in the governor's plan for services that
are considered essential
for the any folks that need the additional services, mm-hmm. That are underserved populations. So we actually fall within those guidelines to be able to continue our services. But we want families and everyone to absolutely know that it is a very deliberate plan. It's very secured. And we primarily, not only the safety of our community, but the people that are doing the work, we need to keep them
safe as well. Yes.
And at low risk to work. And so we do not want anyone to get sick because if we have the virus that comes to our workers, then we won't be able to provide this service.
Right.
And so
thank you.
It is essential to us to keep those protocols in place.
And I want to try to go back to Terry for a moment. Terry, we reestablished the call. Hopefully it's a little better. In about a minute, how will you deliver food under this new mandate that the governor's put in place today?
Yeah, we've already started our meal delivery program, and some are delivered by snow machines. Some are delivered, students have to come and pick them up. Of course, we practice social distancing with that. And then some may be delivered by, we have delivery points throughout the villages that they can go and pick up the meals.
All right. And Tammy, in our final moment here, how can educators themselves maintain their own mental health during this time? This is very frustrating for teachers who are used to being nurturing and up close with students and helping them. What advice do you have for them?
The same conversation that there are between psychotherapists and clinicians, psychologists, healthcare givers, is take care of yourself. And you don't even know at the end of the day how stressed you are because you take in and you take in and you take in. So have like a designated person that you talk with, share what was going on, how you feel. Do it even structured. That helps immensely. And again, knowing it's about reaching out and doing it together.
All right. Thank you so much for being here this evening. The challenge facing parents, students, and teachers during this unplanned school closure will call for a lot of patience from everyone involved. For urban students, distance education may be easier to deliver online, but it will still be difficult to stay on task with assignments when there isn't a teacher or another student nearby to lend a hand. For rural students, the instruction delivery logistics are even more daunting. As you heard this evening, the good news is that school officials are working hard to provide materials in whatever form is needed, whether that's a download or a package by mail. Routine is important for students to keep up with their education and to maintain a healthy mind. Parents, help your kids. And kids, help your siblings. Host study or reading groups online. Get outside and get fresh air and exercise to stay physically active. And above all, practice good hygiene, social distancing, patience, and kindness. That's it for this edition of Alaska Insight. We'll be back next Friday, right after Washington Week. You can find past episodes of the show and related content at our website, alaskapublic.org/AlaskaInsight. Thanks for joining us this evening. I'm Lori Townsend. Good night.